took us half a season, but finally, Mike Johnson has made it onto the Puck Culture Podcast. What's up? It's 2020. Jackie Redmond here with Johnny himself, MJ. You know, I was just quoting The Rock, right?
Yeah.
Did you pick up on that?
No, you know I don't pick up on all your wrestling lingo. I haven't watched wrestling since I played. And we'll have a bit of a wrestling theme in today's show.
A little bit. How many references can we work in? I think you're capable of maybe working in three WWE/WWF in your day,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, my one roommate, Denny Goche in Arizona,
okay,
his uncles were the Rougeau brothers.
Oh.
Who are famous, apparently, wrestling tag team.
Okay.
So he made me watch wrestling at like 30-year-old man.
Hey, listen, there are lots of 30-year-old
I'm the minority.
Plus men.
I get it.
Yeah, you
I get
totally
it.
Are. But the reason we bring it up, Eric Young's going to join the show, WWE professional wrestler himself. He's also a huge hockey fan, Predators specifically, and he writes about fantasy hockey as well for The Athletic. So he'll be joining us a little bit later, but I want to see what you're made of. I want to see if you can get
But also, I resent the implication that it took half a year. Somehow I was asked and I was too busy. This is the first time I've been asked to come on and I showed up at the first opportunity.
This is true.
Falls more on your shoulders than mine.
But I've been making WWE references for a long time, and you have been letting them go over your head for a very long time. Because
comfortably sailing white over my
head. We've known each other for quite a few years at this point. So
yes.
I would say we've been buds. We're like old friends at this point, right?
Yeah, 10 years-ish, long time.
Well, like when I first started probably in Toronto, right?
I was just starting in Toronto too, maybe at the same time as you were, so.
Yeah,
we're both rookies together.
Figuring it out as we go, and now here we are on the Puck Culture podcast. But you know what? You joke about, like, I'm the minority. There are so many professional athletes that secretly love WWE. I've discovered this because I used to cover wrestling back in the day. And you slowly start to realize, like, not a lot of them want to put it out there, like, on the map. But there's a lot of professional athletes that are wrestling fans.
We had a game going on one of the planes where we had like little portable devices to play against each other.
Yeah.
And the only thing we could play was wrestling. And we'd play. Shane Doan got so into this video game wrestling, WWE.
Yes.
And like we'd have eight of us playing in some sort of Royal Rumble
action. I always
knew
I liked Shane Doan.
And Doaner would be just yelling at people off the front of the plane because the wrestling video game wasn't going the way
Who
he wanted.
Who was his favorite wrestler, do you know?
I couldn't tell you. If it's not Hulk Hogan, I don't know.
All right, we'll have to get to the bottom of that at some point. Maybe you can text him after the pod and see if he can remember who his favorite wrestler is. Well, it is a new year, 2020. You're a very opinionated guy. Anybody that watches you knows this. It's one of your strengths.
Mm-hmm.
Are you a New Year's resolution guy?
No.
Why? I know you have reasons. What are they?
Well, because if I wanted to do something about my life, I would just do it. I don't need to.
You don't need January
1st. The flip of a
1st.
Calendar doesn't really matter. If I wanted to go on a diet, I should have gone on it 10 days ago when I wanted to go on a diet.
Why do you think most people, because the majority of people do find themselves motivated going into a new year, why is it that do you think that we need like a calendar to motivate us?
That's just it. I think about historically, not now where you look on your phone and you scroll down and all the months blend into each other. Think about when you're a kid, you had a calendar that had numbers on it. When the numbers finished, you flipped the page and went to the next month. There was something symbolic about turning the page.
Flipping the page on your life.
Into something you want to try to do differently and easier to start when you're starting fresh. Maybe you're putting a new routine in the calendar. Well, it's easier to put in when it's a brand new month instead of starting on a random Thursday that's the 17th.
Right, but realistically, to your point, if you're serious about your New Year's resolution, you could flip that page anytime.
Exactly. Do you?
I like to set new goals at the start of the year. I used to be a resolution girl, but I never followed through with them. So now I just reevaluate my goals I'm constantly working towards.
Like, I know everyone wants to keep them private, right? These are generally kind of private things. I want to do this or change that or get better at this or...
Yeah.
But I'm going to make
I'll be honest.
Give me one or two that you might have
So anyone that follows me on Instagram, I've got like fitness goals. So those continue. But fitness is a journey, right? Like,
Line for that, though, unless you want to run a marathon or something.
So I have a whole thing about before and after photos. Okay. I don't believe in them anymore. It's before and now. Because there's no after because you're not finished.
Right.
Because when you reach your certain fitness goals, like if you don't maintain them or push for more, then you just regress.
Okay.
But so one of my goals for 2020, I can't believe I'm going to admit this. I want to write a book. So not like a biography book. I want to write a novel.
Fiction.
Yeah. I want to write a story.
Do you have an idea?
I do.
We're not gonna
share it.
Do you have a publishing agent?
No, not yet. I want to write like an outline first.
Well, you can talk to me after the pod, and we'll.
We can discuss. We can discuss. Somebody, or maybe it's a screenplay. Maybe it's a screenplay.
Somebody's asked me to do. I've been asked to do that before. To write a book?
About your career?
And I'm like, obviously my career is not interesting enough to write a book about.
Hey, I'm sure it is. It depends how much you want to share.
Well, what I could share would not be that interesting. And then the idea was it doesn't have to be about your career, just about your time in the NHL. But yeah. I tried to start.
And?
It's hard.
Yeah.
Like, I tried to write it.
Okay.
So I didn't talk to someone to have them write it for
Which
me.
Which is what most people do, let's be clear.
Yeah. So I thought, you know what, let me just try to explore ideas. Yeah. And you know I'm a number person. I'm not a literary person.
Right.
And so, like, to write an article, to write a chapter, it was more than I was ready to take on, for sure. It was hard.
Yeah, I expect it to be difficult. That's why sometimes I teeter over and I'm like, maybe it's a screenplay.
Oh, I like it. I am excited
just
for 2020
now. Just because I'm a visual,
now.
Like, I have an imagination. I'm a visual person.
Do you know how to write a screenplay?
No,
have
but I've been Googling. One? I've been Googling.
So I one time was on the plane besides James Gandolfini.
Okay.
The guy who played Sopranos.
Whoa.
Yeah.
That's cool.
And we were going from New York to LA, so it was a long flight. So I was, and he was reading a script. So you want to be respectful of his space, but I'd be lying if I didn't say I read the entire thing with him. Like, every page I was reading.
You're like glancing over.
Oh, I wasn't glancing. I was hunking over to see what he got there.
Meanwhile, he's getting off the flight after like this dude on the plane.
Yeah. He's calling security on the way
what
off the plane.
What was it about?
It was like a family-based, not a comedy, a drama, like a family-based drama. But but it's not like a novel.
Right,
like,
it's
very
different.
Like, I
thought
it would read something like a novel, but no, it's written, so.
You have to put a lot more detail into a novel, whereas a screenplay, I think you have to know, like, what's the scene, what's the dialogue, because that tells the story more so than having to describe the color of the room and the fact that we're sitting in red chairs. You don't need that in a screenplay because you're going to see it.
But in brackets, there are little parentheses, there's always, like, they have the dialogue, but then they also have Jackie walks in the room.
Yeah,
she,
like,
looks angry.
How
Whatever.
Does it happen?
Yes.
How does it all transpire?
I'm looking forward to this from you. This is big news.
Yeah, now every time I see you, like, screenplay, how's it coming? And we're only a few minutes into the podcast, and already I've made it all about me. It's like a talent, a little bit. But let's go to hockey. Let's talk some hockey. Winter Classic in the books. First one that I haven't worked in 3 years, and it was finally in a warmer client.
It didn't look warm, though, watching on TV.
It didn't.
It looked blustery and Tucson.
Were you at Citi Field a couple years ago?
No.
That was cold.
No.
People were drinking beers that were freezing before they were done. That's how cold it was outside.
It's good for beer sales.
It's
all about
true.
The bottom line.
You know what, though? Interesting Winter Classic, though, because you got the Dallas Stars, who got off to that super slow start. Now they're on fire. They look legit. And then you've got the Nashville Predators, who just can't seem to live up to expectation. What do you make of what's going on with the Preds right now? Should they be better than their record states?
Yeah. I mean, you look at their roster. They have a really good team. They have a whole bunch of good players, and in all positions.
Yeah.
And their goaltending has been a problem all year long. Pekka Rinne was great the two previous seasons, and Juuse Saros' backup is, I think, one of the best young goalies
in
the league.
He's been great.
And yet, between the two of them, they're not really giving them above-average goaltending, which they had in years past. Roman Josi's having a great year, but keeping pucks out of the net has been an issue, goaltending-related, but also team-related. And up front, how long have they been looking for centermen in Nashville?
How long have they been trying to get Matt Duchene? Or how, like, long has he been
trying to get
the
there.
Center of...
But, like, you think about from the... They went and got Ryan Johansson, trying to address their needs. They gave him Seth Jones for him. They signed traded and signed for Kyle Turris, trying to address their center needs. They signed Nick Bonino, trying to address... They signed Matt Duchene. And think about all that money. If you added it all up, that's probably 25, $26 million in centermen. And they're still not getting great production out of the middle.
Yeah.
And I don't necessarily know if that's... That the players aren't good enough to produce? I think they are. I think they're all kind of underachieving, which, when you're in a team that is supposed to do well, has a
that
roster
that was in a cup final three years ago,
and has a roster that deserves those expectations, and you're not meeting them, changes happen. I don't know what those changes are going to be, but changes happen. Now, they're still right around the edge of the playoffs. They're not kind of out of it by any stretch, but it's getting to a point now in Nashville where, you know, questions will be being
He's
asked
surrounding
within the organization.
Laviolette for sure, right? Like, the pressure is on him right now. some people seem to believe that the team, that he's lost the team. It's a cliche, yeah. right? Is that a real thing? You know, can you see that when you watch games that maybe players are less engaged than they normally are? And does that fall on the coach or is that on the players?
That's a good question, Jackie. So, like, Mike Babcock lost the Leafs.
Yes.
And I think that was true. I think that was clear. I think you kind of saw in some of the body language, some of the commentary. But unless you're right around the team, we watch games every night.
Yep.
We watch them closely.
But I can't say if
No, but, like, sometimes I can't say if Nashville. Like, I'm not around the room enough. I'm not around the players enough. You almost have to be right there and kind of feel what it's like more so than watch
how they
play.
What about as a player? Can you sense it in the room?
It doesn't happen often. It doesn't happen often where a team kind of, a lot of times players or a team doesn't like their coach,
yeah.
but they generally do what they're supposed to do.
Right.
They try their best.
They have their own lives to read.
Yeah, they have their own motivation to take care of their own selves. But not very often do teams kind of collectively say, and whether it's actually articulated at a dinner or, you know, a night out, like, you know, this guy.
Or like this power play, why are we doing it this way?
Or like, if they're like in the back of the cab.
The Uber.
Yes.
Uber
so,
drama of, what was that, 2018?
A couple of years ago with Ottawa. But I don't know, but that's the sports. You can't get rid of all the players. You're committed to this group. If you need to make a change, it's much easier to change the coach than it is to change the players.
I would say, too, the Predators are a good example or maybe indication of how small your window can be now in the NHL and how quickly mm-hmm. other teams get better, divisions change, and
Winnipeg's
the dynamics
same thing,
change. And maybe that's what's happening with the Preds. It's just, you know what, a few years ago, yeah, they were in the Stanley Cup final, but a few years ago in the NHL is an eternity.
Yeah, things change quickly. You're absolutely correct. And it's hard. And maybe we have to give more credit to the teams that are able to extend it, like Pittsburgh has, like Washington has, for 10, 12, 14 years. And I understand they have great players, but a lot of teams have great players. And because of the way the cap works and the way the salaries have gone, they've not been able to keep it open. Winnipeg, we thought, would be ready for 6 or 7 years of a run. Turned into maybe two.
Then they lost their whole blue line.
Toronto, we thought they'd be good for a half dozen years. And, you know, they might be in one of their two remaining years. And they haven't even won a playoff series yet. So it does go quick. Nashville's been good for a long time. I'm not sure what's going to happen there, but I will say this.
If it was you, if you're the GM.
I'd change the coach.
Okay.
Yeah.
Would you have done it sooner?
Listen, Peter Laviolette, that's a great coach.
Sure.
Hall of Fame coach. But I would probably be around now. Not sooner. I let everyone give them time to work it through and try to sort things out. But, yeah, I probably do. But I will give this up to Nashville. Nashville fans traveled.
They did.
Massive sections of the Cotton Bowl in yellow. I was so impressed. The green, I love the jerseys. We can get to that later. But
I like the color of the jerseys. I didn't like the look of the Stars jerseys.
Oh, I like the green.
Again, everybody points to the color, but the actual logo?
I don't care enough about them. It's just kind of like the experience.
No, sorry.
That's a thumbs down.
I like the green, though. Don't get me wrong. The green, the color.
Yeah.
Perfect. The look.
The logo and everything else. People get very passionate about that.
It's like the new thing to love and to hate is the jerseys.
I played in
sweaters.
Those jerseys. I never cared enough like one way or the other. I had the worst jersey of all time, that Coyotes Kachina thing on. And I'm like, yeah, I don't like it, but whatever.
I hate that jersey, though.
Well, you didn't have to wear it. It was tight collar, sandpaper-like collar. It was terrible.
Oh, okay. I never liked the Boston Bruins jersey that just had, the bear on it. It was, just the bear.
The honey bear,
That's it. Didn't like those. I thought those were weird.
They are weird. Those were the fishermen for the Islanders. But, I would have to wear them, and I would never feel that passionately about, that's a terrible jersey.
You
How
would
can
think
you do
it would
that?
Be the reverse. Like,
You'd
I
think.
Have to wear this every
right.
day. I got to take pictures in this thing, and I hate
and
it.
And that whole look good, feel good, play good thing. You walk on a jersey that looks like, Captain Highliner with the Islanders. You're thinking, I don't know if I'm feeling this one. But I will say, though, Nashville, I give them respect because their fans
traveled
really well.
They have a great
really
fan
well.
Base. Great fan base, for sure. You mentioned the Pittsburgh Penguins. We've got to talk about them because now they lose Jake Guentzel.
That was one of the scariest. So can you remember the last injury? Now, there's actually been a few, but where you saw it happen and it kind of took your breath away, like you're worried.
You were just like,
I was doing that game. I called that broadcast game.
Vinny Trocheck, I thought his injury.
Oh, I called that game
that last
too.
Year?
I did that one too.
Jeez, you're bad luck for some of these guys.
When Trocheck broke his ankle, that was awful, and
yeah,
you could
that
hear him screaming.
Bad. Oh.
But doing the replay on Guentzel last week, and seeing him crash. I'm between the benches. Like, I get it. It's physical. I hear it. I see it. I see guys come off cut and broken bones and fingers looking the wrong way. And you're like, okay, that's unpleasant. It's going to hurt. But we've all kind of seen it. That Gensel one, that was awkward enough that I went...
As a broadcaster, because you're in the moment, right? Like, you're trying to tell the fans what's going on. When it's extreme like that, whether it's maybe a hit to the head or a concussion or something that just looks, ugh, or you can hear them in pain, how do you tackle that? Is that something that you've just gotten better at over time? Because I would imagine it's a little difficult because you don't want to say the wrong thing or assume something about the injury that's inaccurate.
Yeah, although I told the line playing doctor on the broadcast all the time. Yeah, and I find myself to be accurate more often than not. But you're right, like, that balance between you want to explain what's happening, but also appreciate the human element that this guy is hurt.
Yeah.
And no better example, my very first year doing color was when Max Pacioretty got hit in the turnbuckle.
Ooh, I remember
wrestling
that.
Wrestling reference, turnbuckle?
What's that? Oh, yeah, good, you
by
got one.
By Zdeno
Chara,
ding, ding, that's one.
Ding, ding, ding.
And it was maybe my 10th game, and I didn't know, I thought he might...
It was like, bad. That was bad.
Yeah. And so I wasn't sure, what am I supposed to do here? Am I supposed to talk about the injury or the play that happened? Or am I supposed to say, this how scary this is that, you know, a very serious situation is going on. So trying to toe that line, I guess there's no real good way to do it. But I will say, when watching Gensel's, I was bothered. I knew that something bad had just happened. And sure enough, surgery 4 to 6 months and the Penguins are down.
It's a long list of man games missed due to injury for the Pittsburgh Penguins and to their core players.
Yeah.
When you look at their coach, is he like a front runner for coach of the year based on where you see where the Pittsburgh Penguins are in the standings despite all of it?
He is now that you've mentioned it.
Because he's got to be, right?
I probably wouldn't have thought of him in that way because anyone who coaches one of those really good teams, they have, like John Cooper broke records last year and he didn't win coach of the year.
Yeah.
So how great does your year have to be if you have one of the good teams? And Pittsburgh has one of the good teams, but they haven't had one of the good rosters healthy.
Yeah.
So you make a really good point. And the fact that Pittsburgh, if you look at the numbers under Mike Sullivan this year, they're one of the top couple 5-on-5 defensive teams in the league. Now, you wouldn't have thought that with Dumoulin being out and Schultz being out and Crosby and Malkin and Rust and all Gensel now. You're thinking this team, one, is going to have trouble winning
Everyone
games.
Everyone has missed time on that team.
But beyond that, like, can they reimagine their roster and become a defensive team? And he has done that. So he does deserve a lot of credit for...
He should certainly be in the conversation.
For flipping the script like that and then getting the guys to buy in. But you also wonder, and I've said this before, when the best players are not playing, so Sidney Crosby, Malkin, Schultz, Letang, who... When they're replaced by Sam Lafferty, it's a lot easier for the coach to get Sam Lafferty to do exactly what he wants. He won't do it as well, but he'll do exactly what he's told every single time. I think when you take some stars out of the lineups, the lineup gets a little bit more receptive to coaching because they don't have enough experience, they want to be their coach's good books, they can't do it any other way to win, and so... He probably has a pretty receptive room right now to play exactly as he is telling them to.
That's a really good point, and it makes me think of, perhaps this is a weird question, but when you've got a guy like Sidney Crosby, one of the best to ever play the game, out of the lineup, I don't want to say that when he's in the lineup, other third and fourth line players rely on their stars to get it done.
No.
But I think there's
that.
An expectation.
Don't say that. That's exactly
that,
what happens.
You know, you're out there and you're like, well, we have Crosby, like, he'll, you know, Crosby, Malkin, whoever it is. When those guys are out of the lineup, maybe some other players feel a little more comfortable hanging onto the puck or doing things that maybe otherwise they wouldn't necessarily do. Is that crazy
to
say?
Well, I don't know if the other players play out of their comfort zone when Crosby's not around. I think it's more that they have a bigger responsibility. And in the short term, they kind of rise to the occasion because it's a really unique opportunity.
Right.
And there's this kind of motivational, okay, guys, we have to do it together. We have to do it collectively. We have to buy in all together because otherwise we won't win. Because we're not good enough. But what happens, and I'll be curious to see, as Crosby is very close to returning.
Yes.
When the superstar comes back, all those guys who were playing so engaged and so locked down, now they don't play as much. They won't be on the power play. They won't be required. And whether the team wins or loses will have less to do with them just because of the nature of the team. And a lot of times when you get star players back, there is a 5 to 7 game exhale for a lot of those players. Like, oh, God, we got Sid. Thank God Sid's back because, you know, that was stressful.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't be surprised if there's, you know, I've been on teams where the star comes back and you take a bit of a step back. You think you'd take a step forward.
Yeah.
All the progress made without him, then you add him to the mix. But human nature being what it is, guys can take a bit of a relaxation when the star returns.
Really, really quick, the goaltending situation in Pitt.
Mm-hmm. Tristan Jarry's the guy.
Jarry's the guy.
Matt Murray bumped Flower.
Short term. So they've been here before.
They're not afraid to go the hot hand if the hot hand takes them as far as they need to go. And Matt Murray, as great as he's been, he's won two cups. He doesn't yet have the pedigree that says, you have to play him, you can't play Jarry.
Right.
He's still of the age and of the experience where it's, you got to play the best player that gives the best chance to win. Right now, Tristan Jarry's the best goal in the league.
So what about moving forward? Do you move Matt Murray?
No.
You just deal with that later.
You keep on both. We know you need two goalies in the NHL. You keep them both, and you play Jarry as long as he's playing well. And if that means right through the playoffs, then great, because then you have a great chance to win because he's that good.
That's been a big part, too, of them getting through all these injuries, too, is Tristan Jarry has really risen to the occasion.
Exactly.
Recently.
And then if something happens, you have Matt Murray, who has stepped in midstream before.
Totally.
He's stepped into the playoffs before and won cups. So they're in a really good position. Salaries won't dictate what they have to do, but they'll ride the goalie. They've done it before. They'll do it again. And Matt Murray can't complain. He did the same thing to Marc-Andre Fleury.
Yeah, exactly. It's weird how life can come full circle sometimes. But it was the Pittsburgh Penguins that the Predators faced in the mm-hmm. final a few years back. We talked about the issues the Preds have been having. I'm curious to see what Eric Young thinks. Our guest on today's show, WWE superstar and super, super big hockey fan. Eric, what's going on?
Jack, how are you?
Happy New Year.
You guys. Yeah, Happy New Year to you, 2020. It's pouring rain here in Nashville, but yeah, I was down at the Winter Classic, had an amazing time. Dallas was an amazing place to really spend a couple days, but the Predators are in trouble.
Wow, right
Ooh,
to
let's get
it.
Right. Well, I told you, this guy's legit.
I was going to ask about the Winter Classic. We'll get to that in a minute. They're in trouble. You watch them all the time. What's plaguing them? How do you fix them?
Yeah, I feel like saying this statement is like cutting out my own heart, but it comes down to me. It's just the goaltending has been way too inconsistent, which has really never been a thing. As long as I've been here since 2004, hasn't been a thing here. The goaltending from Vokoun to Mason to Ellis to Rene, he's been dominant for years and years. And I don't want to say age is caught up to him because he proved a bunch of people wrong in the last couple of years. But, being a butterfly goalie for that long and dropping down on your knees thousands of times a week, eventually it's going to catch up to you. I'll live forever, but not everybody can say that.
That's funny. Eric, I've been calling Pekka Rinne's slowdown for about 2 years now. Now, he proved me way wrong. I might have missed the window because he was great, as you mentioned. But, listen, goalies who are in their mid to late 30s are generally not very good. But you're supposed to have UC Saros to pick up the slack. And even he has had nice moments, but maybe not quite ready yet either.
Yeah, like you said, nice moments. And I think I had this discussion. I actually had like a bit of a get-together with Chris Mason and Hal Gill. We hosted this thing down in Dallas on New Year's Eve. Had a great turnout. It was just all Preds all night. And what came up with Saros is, can he be the guy? And to me, it comes down to physics and science. It's just goalies are tall now, and mm-hmm. he's definitely not tall. It's just playing that style and playing how goalies play nowadays, being short is a detriment. I don't care how fast you are. With the new sticks, the players are better, technology is better, and it's just hard for a goalie of that stature to be super effective all the time. That's just what I believe. I don't have anything to back that up, but I think it just comes down to physics.
Well, there's a reason why no goalies are under 6 feet tall in the league anymore.
Yeah.
I think there's like two of them. He's
right.
One of them. They're a dying breed for that reason. You're right.
You mentioned your event on New Year's Eve. Obviously, you're out at the Winter Classic in Dallas. Was that your first Winter Classic experience, or have you been to a Winter Classic before?
No, I was at the one in 2014, Maple Leafs versus Detroit. Both of them were rotten hockey teams. I think Leo Komarov was the best player on the Leafs at the time.
Uncle Leo.
But I can say, it was my number one sports memory of my life. Yeah. Me and my best friend were there. We were about 12 rows up, right on the 50-yard line. It snowed all day. I was frozen, but it didn't matter. The Leafs won in a shootout. The hockey was in slow motion, so even I could follow it. So it was fantastic. But I'll say this. Dallas did a great great job. Look, the arena's old. It was really hard to get inside. I'm sure you guys saw the video and pictures of I was in the middle of that. It took us over an hour and 10 minutes to get from outside into our seats. I mean, just complete lunacy. But it's an old building, not over 90 years old. But Dallas is amazing. Everyone was so nice. There's bad apples in every bunch, but the Dallas fans were super cool. I love the Dallas Stars, and Jamie Benn is one of my favorite hockey players for the last 5 or 6 years. So I'm going to lose to a team. That would be the team I want to lose to. But, man, it hurts. I mean, Dallas Stars are legit. I'm a Preds fan, but they were my pick to win the Stanley Cup at the start of the year. And they're looking real good right now.
How did you feel about their chances 3 weeks in the season?
Not good. I felt like maybe I didn't know what I was talking about at all.
You and everyone else. Now, listen, I played in the alumni game of that Detroit-Toronto matchup.
Right.
So
I remember.
It was great. It was, and my parents came down and they watched and they sat at the big house and watched it in the snow. It was
like a winter wonderland.
It was an idyllic
too.
Scene, yeah. More so than really good hockey. But what are you gonna do?
Yeah.
Now, where does this passion for hockey come from? You, it's clearly genuine. Where does it come from?
Yeah, I mean, I was born in Canada, as you guys know. They don't give you a lot of choice. So you love Canada or you move to the United States. That's just how it goes. I live in Nashville now, which is how I became a Nashville Predators fan, but Maple Leafs fan since birth. I've played, basically my whole life. Thought I was going to play in the NHL until high school, and I played against a guy that was had just been drafted to the OHL, and that's when I realized that I was a very, very poor hockey player.
What position did you play?
Do you remember that guy's name?
Nathan Sewell. He was drafted 4th overall in, I can't remember the year, but he was like 6'4", almost 300 pounds. He was born in my hometown of Florence, Ontario, was an unbelievable player. Actually didn't end up playing at all in the OHL, I don't think. I think he just fell out of love with hockey and wanted to start a family, and just it was too much pressure for him. But it was a guy that I went to school with him, and he was unbelievable. And I played against him when he was after he had quit the OHL, and he was so good. There's nothing you could do about it. And that was when I was like, well, I couldn't even play in the OHL even if I wanted to. So I went a different way, but I still love it. I still play hockey at least twice a week. Today, I do a fantasy podcast on The Athletic called Four Stacked Lines. I write for The Athletic, which if my mother was still here, it would probably make her cry. It's been cool, man. Hockey is probably my number one passion outside of wrestling. I'm living the dream big time.
Well, that leads me to my next question. You still find time to play pickup hockey. You write fantasy articles for The Athletic. You write regular hockey articles for The Athletic. And you're a professional wrestler. Like, where do you find the time to do all of this? Because, for anyone listening that maybe doesn't watch wrestling or doesn't know that world, like, it is a hectic schedule. You guys are on the move all the time. It's not just the TV shows. There's the live house shows. So how do you manage all of that?
Technology has made it. I was talking to some guys the other day and saying, I watch probably over 200 games a year, and that's because I have center ice package. I mean, we were just in Saudi Arabia, and I'm watching, I'm setting my alarm to wake up at 3:30 a.m. to do cardio so I can watch hockey because that's when it airs. So
Crazy. The
other excuse is that I'm a complete psychopath. that's really the only answer. I absolutely love the game. Doing podcasts and having another audience, the wrestling audience, is allowing me to maybe bring attention to the game that I love. I mean, the truth is they've got the same problems that pro wrestling has, and pro wrestling is a massive thing, but if you don't get it, then you think it's silly. And I think that's with hockey, especially in the United States, if you didn't, you didn't grow up with it and you don't fully understand what's going on, it's hard to watch. TV does it no justice. So everyone I talk to, I say, just go to a game once, live. It will change your perception. You'll learn a whole bunch by seeing it live and seeing how fast it is, seeing how incredible these players are. And wrestling's the same. TV is cool, but until you see it live, you can't fully understand what's going on. It seems like a trick. It's fake, it's this, it's that. It's, what they're doing isn't real. And then you see it live, and it's real people doing these things, and you hear it, and you see feel it, and the energy of the live crowd, it's totally different. So basically, what I'm saying is my two loves are not good on television, and that's where that's where I make my living. So
you know what?
It's a struggle.
It's a great comparison. I've never actually heard someone describe it that way, but it is, as someone that has covered both in my career, like seeing wrestling live is completely different than watching it on TV. And hockey is the same way. So that's actually a great comparison.
You'd be proud of me to know I went to WrestleMania, the Sky Dome.
What year?
Back in the day, like 86, 87 or something, like when it was first coming to Toronto.
That's
50,000 people. I was one of the first big ones to get outside. First WrestleMania, I think, outside.
Who was headlining? Do you remember?
You know, when I was a little kid, I had the little wrestling dolls in the ring, and it was like Hulk Hogan and the Ultimate Warrior and King Kong Bundy and
old
those
school
guys. Yeah, the old school guys. Yeah.
I love it. All right, Eric, can I put you on the spot? I'm going to ask you permission first.
Yeah, please.
Okay, so, you know, you're obviously a professional wrestler, so you guys cut a ton of promos. If you were to cut a promo right now on the spot, I'll give you choices. Would you be willing to cut a promo on the fly?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so you can cut a promo for, you know, why people should watch hockey, like why hockey's amazing, or you could cut a promo for why the Predators are going to turn this thing around and make the playoffs.
All right.
You pick.
One on why the Preds are going to turn this around.
I like that. Right. I was hoping you would pick that one. All right.
So here we go. 2014, this team was almost stolen away from us. Our love of this sport was almost taken by the Basile family and moved to Hamilton. The NHL was almost non-existent in the city of Nashville, Tennessee. But the people of this community, the group of investors stepped in and said, no, this is going to be a hockey town. Fast forward, ESPN voted this the number one sports franchise in North America. The Nashville Predators went to the Stanley Cup and were one goal away from pushing the Penguins to a seven-game series. This is the best team that this team has ever had on paper. You've got scoring. You've got defense. Roman Josi putting this team on his back and leading by example. Pekka, I know that you're better than this. You have shown that you are better than this. The Nashville Predators will make the playoffs this year. They will go deep, and they will make their mark in this season. 2019-2020, the Preds aren't finished. Let's go.
Yeah, I love that. That was good.
I'm ready to fire out of the dressing room right now.
You're ready to go play.
Let's go. Give me some pads. I'm ready to rock.
That was so good. I love it. Preds fans, by the way, very present on Twitter, as I'm sure you know, Eric. Mm-hmm. So when we clip that and throw it on Twitter, Preds fans are going to love it.
I hope so, yeah. I mean, this has been it's such a cool part to be part of this community. Like I said, we had this event. It started as an idea of having 20 or 30 people that I knew were going to be down there, a place for us to kind of, like, be together and drink. And the owner of the bar was sending me pictures on Friday saying there's 300 Predators fans in here. This is the day before. So at 5 p.m., I actually did a spit and chicklets with Biz Nasty and Whitney and Admiral. Yeah, it was an amazing time. But I was getting all these messages saying, man, there's nowhere for us to stand. And, you know, they're sold out of beer. This is, you know, 3 hours before the event. So the Preds showed up big time. Super, super proud to be part of this this group of fans. I can tell you, it's a very niche thing, but hockey has carved out a really, really cool existence in the city of Nashville. It's growing like crazy. It's almost impossible to get ice. I play next Wednesday. Our puck drop is 11:45 p.m.
Oh, my gosh. Late one.
Nice. Now, Eric, listen, not your favorite player, but if you had to describe an NHL player that you would be, like if you were an NHL player, this guy would be the kind of player you are. Not the best guy, but who would you be if you were an NHL player that's currently playing?
It's hard for me to pick a guy in the Preds, but I think Carrier from Vegas.
Carrier. Okay.
I'm still really quick in a straight line. Obviously, there's no contact in rec league, but if there was, I would be a much more effective player. guys kind of give me a wide berth. I play like a lunatic because I'm there for the exercise. Mm-hmm. So I paid my money like everybody else, so I play like a lunatic. But that's probably not very good at handling the puck, but really fast in a straight line and really like hitting people when I play. So That would be the comp.
All right. Okay, that's a good pick. One. I mean, that's
that's nice.
Okay, I'm going to jump.
That's probably said by nobody ever, right?
But no, it's been said by you, though.
The Carrier family.
I'm going to jump off that question and ask you which NHL player you think would make the best WWE superstar.
I mean, Subban, I mean, that's the first guy that comes to mind. You know, he gets entertainment, he gets media. So, yeah, he's
he can
guy
cut a promo, probably.
What about Ryan Reeves? You went to Vegas. That guy understands how to play the villain, the foil, to be the good guy. Yeah. He's a monster. Yeah.
The heel, that's
Ryan
the word you're looking
would
for.
Would be out there for sure.
Could be my second reference.
Guy plays for the Marlies, Rich Clune.
Yeah, Tricky Dicky. Yeah, we know him from Toronto. Yeah. Absolutely.
Loves wrestling. Mm-hmm. And he's got the personality for sure. He's got, you know, like the Tricky Dicky alter ego almost. Yep. But yeah, he's a super good dude, really interesting guy. I mean, kind of looks like a pro wrestler already. So,
Brad Marchand would be pretty good too, right? Like, he could be a good heel, don't you think?
Well, definitely. I mean, he gets the role. I mean, I think, you know, if you hear
people
that play
hate
with him.
Him
or know him, they're like, they love this guy. I mean, if you know the guy, but when you play against him or you're a fan of another team or whatever, being a Maple Leafs fan, I can say that I hate that I have to play that, you know, that they have to play Boston every year. and no one that is that effective should be that good. You know, he's kind of good at everything. So he's an unbelievable player.
That's what bugs you the most about Marchand. If you're not a fan of his,
it's like so good.
You'd love to hate him, be like, that guy sucks, except he's amazing. So not only is he annoying because he's annoying your team, but he's annoying because he's beating your team at the same time. It's tough.
Anti-Bruins hecklers must have a real hard time. Like, if you're a heckler and you're going to a game in Boston and you're seeing the Bruins somewhere else, you can't be like, yo, Marchand, you suck. Because people around you will just laugh and be like, yeah, good one, bud. That's not very good. Yeah. What about WWE wrestlers as hockey players? Like, is there a WWE superstar you would love to see try to skate?
I tell Bobby Lashley every time I see him that I want to fight him on the ice. he put a video out of him skating with his daughter, and he can barely move. It's the only time I would have an opportunity to even land a shot. So, I would fight him. You know, Brock Lesnar, I think he's from Minnesota, so he might be able to skate, so I wouldn't have opened my mouth then. But Luke Harper is a guy, he just left the company, but he still plays.
Oh, he's a big hockey fan, right?
Yeah, huge hockey guy, giant Maple Leafs fan from Buffalo originally, moved up to Tampa, and he's playing a couple open games down there. Christian J. Riso used to be a pretty good goalie, and interesting trivia question is Jay Riso used to hand his equipment down to former goalie Ellis from the Nashville Predators.
No way. Right.
Dan Ellis, yeah, nice.
Interesting.
Little wrestling hockey lineage there.
Who knew?
I like that. Well, now I just want to see you and Lashley fight on ice.
Yeah, me too.
Do it for charity. Pull the Bieber Binnington move and do it for charity.
it'll be the opening card for the Bieber
Binnington
breakaway.
Showdown.
These guys can fight, and then Bieber can come out there and try to score on Binnington at the All-Star game.
Hey, I'd pay to see it.
Would probably beat me up on ice anyways, but I would still try.
I think the real winners there would just be the viewers, right?
There you go.
Yeah, exactly. All right, one more for you. It is a new year. We talked off the top of the show, Johnny and I, about New Year's resolutions. Are you a New Year's resolution guy?
I'm not. Yeah, okay. I've never been a thing. And, me and my wife actually had a conversation about this yesterday, just saying, like, I don't need a specific day to be better. You mean it's just I don't need an excuse or
tell America
a timeline on it. I'm just trying to do it all the time. Trying to improve myself. I can say I'm 40 and I'm in the best shape I've ever been in my life. Don't wait for a day. Just do it now. If New Year's is your starting day, then go for it. But you don't have to set a date on making yourself better.
Listen, this guy's got it going on, and you said it more eloquently than I tried to. So I ditto.
That's what I meant. That's what you meant earlier in the show. I love it. All right, Eric, always a pleasure talking hockey with you. Let us know next time you're in the New York, New Jersey area so we can bring you in and have you on the show again.
Will do. Love talking to you guys. Thanks for having me.
See ya.
All right. Go Preds.
Eric Young's great. I don't know if you've ever seen his WWE character. Insane. Like, insane, actually.
So I have not watched his character in full flight, but I have a picture of what I think he would be like now, having spoken to him. So now I'm going to go check to see if my mind's eye matches the reality.
Yeah, anybody
he's
listening,
not a huge guy.
If you don't watch wrestling, just go Google Eric Young.
He's not super big, though.
No, right. no, no. I mean, he's jacked, but he's not big. But yeah. his character is insane. So, I don't know. YouTube it. Check it out. Great dude. Huge hockey fan. You can also find him, again, on The Athletic. He writes fantasy hockey stuff. So
he's said he was 40.
Yeah.
So he's 5 years younger than me. So he would have been a teenager when I played. He would have been like 17. I wonder if he ever saw me play for the Leafs.
He probably did. He probably did. He said he was a Leaf fan.
Yeah.
He wouldn't have moved to Nashville until later, I think.
So maybe.
Yeah.
We'll see.
That was around the time he was having his dreams crushed by that OHL player.
Yes, exactly.
That he realized was so much better
than
him.
Sometimes you need to recognize, like, I think I'm good. And then you go against someone who's good. You're like, I am so far from being.
Yeah. Yeah.
At that level.
Fair enough. Did you have a question when you were coming up as a hockey player? Like, before you made it, did you ever question if you could?
Yeah. I mean, we don't probably have enough time for this. But, like, I just stopped playing hockey in high school.
You did?
Yeah, like I played AAA until grade 8.
Yeah.
And then in high school, I stopped playing competitive hockey.
So you stopped for how long?
Grade 9 and 10, I played single A hockey.
Okay.
And the 11th and 12th grade, I played double A hockey.
Wow.
I was the smallest kid in my high school in grade 9.
So you grew late.
Puberty came real late. It's still happening. Puberty.
That's, you know, making it after that is more impressive.
Because
like,
if you
didn't play like hockey growing up and you're just a hockey fan, you're listening, like to go from AAA to double A or to single A and miss that couple of years, like you fall behind quick.
Well, he's talking about playing in the OHL or playing in major junior in Canada. People ask me, why did you play major junior? No one asked me to. Like, I wouldn't have gone anyways, but I was not good enough to be considered. I was never drafted. I was a long shot at best. So
it was a growth spurt for you that sort of changed things?
Yeah, physical maturity and then, yeah. Yeah, so I never really had a moment where I questioned because I never really questioned that I could.
Right.
It wasn't about understand that I couldn't. I never really thought I could. Like in high school, when you're thinking about, what do I want to do? Maybe I can play hockey.
Yeah.
I was like, what do I want to do? I'm going
to
go to university.
You're like, I'm going
to
be a lawyer.
I'm
going to
be a banker.
Is that what you thought? Banker?
Yeah. So
numbers.
I got a degree in finance. That's what I was going to do.
All right. Well, we know that Justin Bieber plays hockey. We just mentioned Bieber and Binnington. We have to get this in the show because it's just so interesting to me. I mean, we all know Bieber's a big hockey fan. He's constantly Instagramming about the Maple Leafs. Mm-hmm. He's from Ontario. It all makes sense. But Jordan Binnington decided to reach out to Biebs on social media after seeing what I assume is like a rec league, beer league, pickup hockey goal for Justin Bieber.
Now, Biebs doesn't go and like join the rec, like the free skate. He gets his buddies and
they
he plays
rent
a,
ice. Yeah.
I don't think he's like with the public.
Could you imagine him dropping in on a game? Just, hey guys, can I play?
A public shinny game? That would be something.
That would be.
Yes.
But he scores a nice goal, posts it in case you missed it. Jordan Binnington then reaches out on social media and says, hey, I want to give you a shot at scoring on me shootout style.
Mm-hmm.
And if you score, I'll bleach my hair platinum blonde.
Right. Which is aggressive.
Which is aggressive.
Yeah.
It's not in right now. You know, this isn't the year 2000. NSYNC is not at the top of the charts. Mm-hmm. But
that's just too bad.
Bieber responds and says, hey, man, I'll do it. But the money goes to a charity of my choice if I score on you.
Forget
how about
the
that?
Bleached hair.
Yeah.
10 grand to the charity of my choice if I get a goal.
Exactly.
Solid retort.
Binnington is going to give him 10 shootout attempts, mm-hmm. which is a lot.
Yes.
Bieber's going to get 10 opportunities. If you were a gambling man, does Bieber score or not score?
If Binnington is trying as hard as he can, I say he doesn't score.
See, you've thought about this the way I have.
Yes.
Is Binnington really going to give his 110% effort the entire duration of the shootout? Or is he going to try really hard for like 9 and then go, you know what, we should donate to charity. Maybe I'll let him have one.
No. He's an athlete. He's a competitor. He issued a challenge. I think he's going to want to try to shut him out.
Ten chances is a lot.
On an NHL, I'm an NHL player. Mm-hmm. On a goalie, on 10 chances, I should score 3.
Okay.
3 or 4.
But if you're Bieber, who's...
I'm an NHL player.
Yes.
I'm not a pop star.
Yeah.
Who has played hockey but doesn't play hockey.
Well said.
Right? So if I, as a player, when I was in the NHL, would score 3 or 4.
Like, that's the average in the shootout, right?
The shootout,
it's
great shootout guy is 40%.
Yeah.
A whole bunch of guys are 20%. Like, it's around 30-something percent. So you're saying that that's when it's the best shooters in the world? I know Justin Bieber is a very talented young man, but the only chance he has to score for real, I thought about this.
Oh, yes.
So if he goes for any kind of move, no chance. Like, he's not going to be able to pull it backhand and beat him. He's not going to be able to beat him far post through it. Like, none of that's going to work.
Okay.
If he looks to shoot, I don't think he scores anywhere. But if he tries to shoot and fans on the puck, misses it. So he's trying to go top glove and kind of mishits it and like dribbles it, not top glove, but kind of over the pad.
Like almost like his, this is just the only way I can think of to say it, his lack of skill will somehow accidentally become an advantage.
So that's why professional poker players don't like playing against amateurs.
Yeah, because Binnington is going to do what
you're,
Binnington's going to do what you're supposed to do. Bieber's just going to do whatever.
He's going to look at his hands and his stick and his eyes like, oh, the puck's coming here. And it would.
Because that's what
real shooter would do. But if Biebs kind of catches one and flubs it and toes it and kind of, that's his best chance.
Here's my take. I think that no matter what happens, if Bieber doesn't score, they're going to donate the money anyways.
Obviously.
That's obviously what's going to happen. But I think if Bieber scores, I think Binnington should still have to dye his hair platinum blonde. Since that was the original.
How long does that last? You have to shave it until it grows out?
It's really not good for your hair. It's not good for your hair.
Men are not really concerned about that.
Like he could dye it.
Taxing your hair with dyes.
Here's the thing. He could dye it and then a couple weeks later dye it back. That's not difficult.
Just shave it.
Guys, shave it off.
And then have it grow back in normal.
Yeah, I mean, all I know is this is great for hockey. Justin Bieber has a ton of fans following him, millions and millions of fans following him. Not all of them, I promise you, are hockey fans. But right now, if Justin Bieber, if the league could somehow figure out a way to get Bieber and Binnington in St. Louis for All-Star to do this.
Yes.
Bieber specifically, obviously. It would be huge for hockey.
Yep.
Huge. There would be so many people watching that specifically.
And the power of the social media that is Justin Bieber, the machine that he is with his 40 million followers.
Oh, my gosh.
It would be, what they should do, really, is regardless. So if, does Justin Bieber have bleached blonde hair right now?
I don't know what he looks like at this moment, but he did have it.
My best friend was at the Leaf game just before Christmas.
Yeah.
Bieber was there. All of a sudden, I see him post a picture with his son and Justin. I'm like... Dave, like, where are you hanging out with Justin Bieber in the AE Scotia, whatever it's called, center? He's obviously in the back alley somewhere. Yeah. But anyways, Scarborough guys, figure out how to get it done. But I would like to see if they both give the money no matter what to participate, and if Binnington stops them, then Bieber does his hair.
Which is nothing for
money for both, and the loser does their hair.
I want to know what Jordan Binnington's motivation was. Like, is Binnington trying to get some publicity?
Me.
He's very quiet unassuming.
You've been around him.
I've interviewed him, yeah.
He doesn't, I can't say that I know him great. Doesn't strike me as a guy who would chase publicity like this.
Right, so what is it? Is it just for fun?
Maybe just got in the spirit and just gave it a whirl. People are firing.
Maybe he knows
people
Bieber.
People are firing their best shots.
You know what? He might know Bieber because his girlfriend is an actress, a Canadian actress. Mm. Maybe it's a setup.
I hope not.
It would ruin the story if that was the case.
Everyone's just shooting their shot on Twitter right now. That's how it works in hockey.
Yeah, that's true. So Beauvillier obviously shooting his shot on Twitter with a very simple, what's up, Anna Kendrick, who, by the way, is a great actress, super funny, gorgeous as well, obviously. This is not the first time we've seen an athlete do it. Was it Taylor Hall that said, sup, Selena Gomez?
Yeah.
A few years ago?
I think she was coming to somewhere for a concert. And he's
something like that. Sup, Selena.
Was she wearing a Hall jersey at a concert?
She might have been wearing a jersey or something.
An Oiler jersey or something, or jersey, whatever
something,
it was. Yeah.
Something happens.
Listen, the power, this is the beauty, the fun part about social media is you can kind of reach out and contact
access.
Someone.
It's access, right?
And they don't have to respond. They don't have to pay attention. But when Anna Kendrick is then inundated with all these, and I read them. Did you read some of the responses?
Did. Beauvillier
says, what's up to whatever, Anna Kendrick. And then a whole bunch of hockey people start tagging her telling how great Beauvillier is. Thank you so much for saving my cat out of the burning building while on your way to serve food at the soup kitchen.
Just making him look like this
like
stand-up guy, loves long walks on the beach, romantic candlelight dinners.
I appreciate the communal effort of the hockey world to help Anthony Beauvillier shoot his shot.
Well, you know, when you played, obviously social media, was not around. But if it was, let's go back in time here, pre-marriage, pre-family Mike Johnson, and you're playing hockey, professional athlete.
Right.
Who would be the celebrity that you'd be saying what's up to on Twitter? Like, and I want back in those years,
late
90s.
Yes. So first off, the Spice Girls were very popular back then.
I know.
Apparently, Ginger.
Yeah.
Jerry.
Yeah.
Hallowell.
Jerry Hallowell. Yeah.
in her album liner note somewhere, thanked a Mike Johnson.
Ooh.
And so I had the very early stages of
people speculated that
thought
it was
me. How did you meet her? How do you know her? I'm like,
that's so
funny. I couldn't even respond. Like, I didn't. But it was.
And this, kids, is why you don't believe everything you
right.
read.
Right. Exactly. Just the same name, which plagues me every time I cross the border. You know, it's Mike Johnson. There's lots of us. But
right.
people thought that somehow we were dating. I'm like, no, never. So I probably would have tried her then because I was in her
right.
album line.
Was she your favorite Spice Girl? Now this is the real meat of the episode.
I'm not gonna lie to you.
Which Spice Girl was your favorite? Can I guess who you would say first?
Well, see, because they all cater to a different part of your personality.
That's true. That's the whole point.
That's the whole point.
Yeah.
Yes. So yeah, go ahead. You can try to guess. Go ahead.
Listen, this is just gut instinct.
Yeah.
Baby Spice. Blonde.
No.
Not Posh, I don't think. Or would it have been Posh?
It would have been Jerry.
Okay.
Or Scary?
Yeah. Mel B.
Mel B.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful
girl. One of those two.
Yeah, okay,
yeah.
I like it. Those two had the fiercest personality. Like, those were the...
They're out there.
Yeah, they were. Okay, back to the original question.
Two original question. If I had to shoot my shot, two times, I would go Alyssa Milano.
Oh, okay, she's a big sports fan.
Yes, and a big hockey fan. Yeah,
she
I
is.
Met her.
So she was your
later,
celebrity crush back in the day.
But, like, back in the day of Who's the Boss, the whole bit, Christine Applegate also would have been one of those.
Ooh, love Christine Applegate.
Those two would have been, because I met Alyssa Milano
were you
at
nervous?
A Wayne... I was excited. At a Wayne Gretzky jersey retirement or something
okay.
when he was coaching. I was not available to talk to her that time, but I'm like,
right.
hey, it's still
a celebrity.
I'm still 16 again.
Yeah.
So I would have Christina Applegate or Alyssa Milano.
Okay.
And the other one would have been Kelly Kapowski.
Oh, of course.
Now,
Tiffany Amber Thiessen.
For the people who don't know who that is, Saved by the Bell was a show that was, you know.
Massive in popularity.
Yes, that's right. And one of the girls' characters on it was
Kelly Kapowski.
Yep. Tiffany Amber Thiessen is an actress's name.
Anybody growing up at that time, she was like the
Lisa
number
Turtle,
one crush.
Kelly Kapowski.
Yeah. And Jesse
Spanos.
Yeah.
Slater.
Well, here's the thing. Tiffany Amber Thiessen was like, she was like this girl next door,
yes.
you know, high school girl in Saved by the Bell. Then she went on and was it 90210? And she was like
she
the bad chick.
Yes.
Yeah, totally different Kelly Kapowski.
Makes
there.
You like her more though. She got different parts of her personality.
Yeah,
she's
yeah.
Also,
she, I love yes. Kelly. I love Tiffany Amber Thiessen. She's fantastic.
So that's mine.
Okay, so those.
Who are yours? Now, if I had to say, now I know Jackie a little bit. If I had to say who like her hockey player crush was.
Oh, God, back in the day? I can tell you who my hockey player crush was.
Yeah, he was traded for me. She likes Darcy. She not liked. She when she was in high school. She liked Darcy Tucker the player.
Yeah, I love Darcy Tucker the player. He's one of my favorite players.
Yes.
I don't know if I ever had a crush on Darcy Tucker.
Just,
but I love Darcy
crush.
Tucker. Hockey crush.
Yes.
Yes. If we're talking like actual crush, like childhood Jackie, I always thought that Steve Sullivan was so handsome.
Yes.
Yeah.
I
found him very handsome back in the day.
He's distinguished now, the assistant general manager for the Arizona Coyotes.
I know. I probably should put that up there, but that was back in the
also,
day.
Also, my centerman, my very first game was Sully.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay.
Here's my Sully story.
Okay. Give me a Sully
real
story.
Real quick. So, first game, I'm playing in Tampa, not practiced with the Toronto Maple Leafs. I signed the day before. They had played the night before. So, I had not met anyone on the team until 5 o'clock night of the game.
Okay.
So, I'm in the dressing room. I'm obviously very nervous and kind of scared. I don't know a lot of the guys. The Leafs were rebuilding. So, the coach goes to put the numbers on the board for the lines.
Sure.
And so, he starts with the first line and he says 94 Sergei Berezin, 13 Matt Sundin, 19 Freddie Modine.
Yeah.
Then he goes 17 Wendell Clark. 11, Steve Sullivan, 20. And I'm like, oh, I'm playing with Wendell Clark, like who I grew up watching.
Like crazy, yeah.
So I look immediately to Clarkie for, you know, confirmation that
like,
it's okay.
Like, is this real? Yeah.
Yeah, and he gives me, like, nothing. He just kind of looks at me. He's so veteran. He didn't do anything. He's just like,
whatever.
And then I look to Sully, who I think I'm older than.
Okay.
But he would been in the NHL. It was kind of his rookie year. And I look to him for affirmation, like, hey, it's gonna be okay, we're gonna have fun tonight.
Yeah.
And he is shaking his head in disgust. He's because he was trying to establish his career and he was thinking, who is this college kid? I don't want to play with this guy. I'm trying to get points here and establish myself as an NHL player. And he kind of was giving like unsure of what was going to happen that
night.
So
Mike Johnson in that moment is so excited looks to one side, dice. Looks to the others. It's like you were looking for high fives and just you were left hanging by like, everybody.
So, no, I got
crushed. Nothing? No? No. Oh, you guys aren't as pumped as me? Okay, no. Great. Moving right along.
Although Sully had 1-1 that night and we won the game.
So then he thought differently a little bit about it. But to answer the real question, which was celebrity, who are my celebrity crushes? This is always a hard question because I'm not a huge like celebrity crush person. But I've always had this weird crush on Mark Ruffalo.
Oh,
always.
Really?
Yeah, and
artistic
people are always shocked by it. People are always like, really?
Strikingly handsome kind of dude,
no,
heartthrob.
But my heartthrob guy would be probably Channing Tatum.
I used to find Channing Tatum
very attractive back in the day. Coach Carter, nobody knows. He was in that movie.
Of course.
That was like his start.
That was that Samuel L. Jackson the coach? No, not Samuel L. Jackson. Yeah, Samuel L. Jackson the coach.
I don't remember.
I think so.
I haven't watched it in a long time.
Yeah, I watched that on occasion.
But Channing Tatum.
He was a troubled basketball player. I watched it.
If I was like a big deal and I could tweet at Channing Tatum back before I was in a relationship, then that would be my guy. Yeah, right. I met him once, actually.
Channing?
I actually met him once. I totally forgot when I was an intern at ET Canada. Him and someone he was co-starring in a movie with, the girl from Mean Girls, they were in a movie together. And I was just an intern. I was like just there to like grab coffees and like just like not let random strangers walk onto the set.
Mm-hmm.
He was there. We had a conversation. He knew my name.
You were the random stranger walking on the set.
Yeah,
you were supposed to stop yourself from getting out there. Nice.
True story though. Anyways, this has been fun. I'm glad you finally came on the show. You'll be back?
As soon as I'm asked.
All right. Well,
I'll see you in a couple weeks.
It won't take too long. A few weeks. We'll get you back in the rotation. But let us know on Twitter using the hashtag Puck Culture. A, if you were, you know, a professional athlete or a celebrity with millions of followers, what celebrity would you tweet at, shoot your shot with?
Mm-hmm.
Let us know. And if you have any New Year's resolutions, we're open to hearing those as well. But this has been the Puck Culture Podcast. We appreciate the time. Thank you for listening, and we'll see you next time. Happy New Year.